Hello friends, in this video we will be discussing about ultimate analysis of code. In the previous video we have discussed about proximate analysis of code, where we had calculated percentage moisture, percentage volatile matter, percentage of ash content and fixed carbon. Here we will be doing, in the ultimate analysis we will be doing the analysis of coal by determining chemical elements like carbon, hydrogen, sulfur and nitrogen. The amount of these constituents will say us the quality of the coal. Anyway, this requires high degree of skill and procedures and very lengthy procedures, and it is tedious process, and the cost of equipments are also high as compared with that of proximate analysis. At first, let us discuss about the procedure for calculation of carbon and hydrogen. For calculating amount of carbon and hydrogen present in the coal, we use a combustion apparatus. Accurately weighed coal sample is burned in oxygen in the combustion apparatus. We have the combustion apparatus here. See, this is the combustion tube. This is the furnace. Here we are sending the amount of oxygen required for combustion. Here we have a U-tube containing anhydrous calcium chloride. Here we have another U-tube containing KOH solution. And the excess amount of oxygen which is not used during the combustion process will be removed from here. Carbon and hydrogen in the coal sample will be converted into carbon dioxide and water respectively. It means that carbon will react with oxygen to form carbon dioxide and hydrogen will react with oxygen to form water. Water will be absorbed by the U-tube containing calcium chloride, and carbon dioxide will be absorbed in the U-tube containing KOH, because calcium chloride can absorb water and KOH can absorb carbon dioxide. There will be increase in weight due to these absorptions. Like here, the increase in weight will say the amount of water absorbed, and here in KOH solution will say the amount of CO2 absorbed. The increase in weight will be determined. Now let us go for the reactions at first. The reactions involved are, carbon will react with oxygen to form carbon dioxide. The hydrogen will react with oxygen to form water. Carbon dioxide will be absorbed in KOH solution to form corresponding K2CO3. And water will be absorbed by the calcium chloride. So there will be increase in weight due to the absorption of carbon dioxide in KOH containing tube and absorption of water, due to which there is increase in weight, the calcium chloride tube. Then the percentage carbon will be equal to increase in weight of KOH tube, that is due to the absorption of carbon dioxide, divided by weight of coal sample taken, multiplied by 12/44 into 100. Now, how this 12/44 came in this? We know that all the elements combine generally in proportions. So, if you say that carbon reacts with oxygen to form carbon dioxide, so according to the law of proportions, we can say that 12 gram of carbon will react with 32 gram of oxygen to form 44 gram of carbon dioxide. It means that 12 gram of carbon will give 44 gram of carbon dioxide. So percentage carbon will be is equal to the amount of carbon dioxide upon weight of coal sample taken multiplied by 12/44 into 100. Percentage of hydrogen is equal to increase in weight of calcium chloride tube due to absorption of water upon weight of coal sample taken multiplied by 2 upon 18 into 100. Here also we can say that 2 gram of hydrogen will react with half oxygen, that is 16 gram of oxygen, to form 18 grams of water. So 2 grams hydrogen can give 18 grams of water. So we can say that the percentage of hydrogen is equal to increase in weight of calcium chloride tube upon weight of coal sample taken into 2 upon 18 into 100. Next, we will be calculating about how much amount, how we are going to calculate the percentage of nitrogen present in the coal. For that, we will be using one Jeldahl's flask. It is a long necked flask. Okay. So in Jeldahl's flask, this is a Jeldahl's flask. At first, we will be taking a known amount of weighed coal sample, known amount of sample, and it will be heated with concentrated H2SO4 and K2SO4. And after heating this, when the solution becomes clear, it will be treated with excess of KOH. See the connections and all. Jeldahl's distillation flask, this will be connected to a condenser, and after this there is a acid solution in the conical flask where the something is absorbed here. So let us know what is being absorbed here. We are making, what we are doing is we are taking coal sample, and at first we are treating it with concentrated H2SO4 and K2SO4, and content will be digest, after digestion it will be treated with excess amount of KOH or sodium hydroxide also we can use. The product formed will be nothing but ammonia. The ammonia that will be liberated during this process in the Jeldahl's flask will be condensed and will be absorbed in a known volume of a standard acid solution. So we can by titrating this acid with some known amount of basic solution, we can calculate how much amount of ammonia is being absorbed in this non-volume of acid solution. So the calculations involved, let us discuss. Let weight of the coal sample taken is W gram. The volume of the standard acid that we have taken is V1ml, where we have absorbed the ammonia solution. Now, suppose the volume of standard alkali is VML, volume of acid left unused is VML. So, the volume of the acid solution used for neutralizing ammonia is V1 minus VML. That is nothing but, suppose it is XML. Then XML, some normality of acid solution we have taken. We have not fixed one normal. We are taking some N1 normal acid solution. So XML, N1 acid solution, which will be equivalent to XML, N1 of ammonia solution. Because we are absorbing this ammonia into this non-volume of acid solution, was even normality is also known. Now, 1000 ml of one normal ammonia, if we want to prepare, we generally dissolve 17 gram of ammonia, and in 17 gram of ammonia, we have 14 gram of nitrogen by weight. So we can say that 1000 ml of one normal ammonia solution will contain 14 gram of nitrogen. Then X ml of N1 ammonia will contain how much? This X multiplied by 14 divided by 1000. Because it is of some normality N1, we are multiplying it with N1 also. So this will be the amount of nitrogen. 14 into X upon 1000 into N1 will be the amount of nitrogen present in the sample. We are going to calculate the percentage of nitrogen. The percentage of nitrogen will be equal to amount of nitrogen divided by the initial weight of sample taken, that is W gram, multiplied by 100. So 14 into X upon 1000 into normal, N1 normal, multiplied by 100. This is for percentage. and divide by initial weight of the sample taken. So this is the weight of, this is the amount of nitrogen, and this is the amount of whole sample taken, multiplied by 100 will give the percentage of nitrogen. So that is equal to 1.4 into N1 into X upon W. So percentage nitrogen can be equal to volume of the acid consumed multiplied by normality into 1.4 upon weight of the sample taken. See, this is the 1.4 which we have considered. N1 is normality of the acid whatever has been taken, and X is the volume of the acid consumed for neutralizing ammonia, divided by weight of the cold sample taken, that was W. Next, let us calculate sulfur. For calculation of sulfur, what we do is we take the washings from Bohm calorimeter in which a known mass of coal is burned. The washings are treated with barium chloride solution, and if the coal contains sulfur, then that sulfur will react with this barium chloride to form barium sulfate. These precipitates are filtered, washed, and heated to constant rate. So barium sulfate, whatever is precipitated, will be filtered, washed, and heated to constant rate. Then the percentage of sulfur will be equal to weight of the barium sulfate obtained from that sulfur present in coal, divided by weight of the sample taken in the Bohm, multiplied by 32 upon 233 into 100. 32 is mass of sulfur and 233 is molecular weight of barium sulfate. Sulfur, 32 gram of sulfur is converted into 233 gram of barium sulfate, multiplied by 100 for percentage. So percentage sulfur is weight of barium sulfate obtained upon weight of sample taken in the Bohm calorimeter, multiplied by 32 upon 233 into 100. Next is ash content. Ash content analysis is carried out as in the proximate analysis that we had discussed even in the previous video. Now for oxygen, what we do is we take the differences. It is obtained by the difference of 100 minus percentage of carbon, hydrogen, sulfur, nitrogen, and ash content. Now let us talk about the importance of ultimate analysis. At first, carbon and hydrogen. Calorific value of fuel is directly related to the amount of carbon present in it. That we have discussed even in the proximate analysis case also. I have repeated many times that more the amount of carbon, more will be the calorific value of the fuel, or you can say better will be the quality of the fuel. Greater the percentage of carbon, higher is the calorific value. So it reduces the size of the combustion chamber also. So we are happy with carbon because the carbon gives some calorific value to the fuel. Now the amount of hydrogen also increases the calorific value of coal, but the problem with hydrogen is that it is volatile in nature, so that affects the quality adversely. Next is nitrogen. Nitrogen has no calorific value and it is undesirable because it adds no value to the calorific value. But in carbonization industries, we can recover it by, like, this will be converted into ammonia or pyridine gases, and it can be recovered. Next is sulfur. Sulfur contributes to calorific value of coal, but it is undesirable because it produces corrosive gases like SO2, SO3, H2S during the carbonization process. All these are undesirable. This causes pollution, and even these are the corrosive gases. Ash content is undesirable, as I have discussed earlier also. This adds no value to the calorific value of coal. Instead, it restricts the air passage of the furnace grate and reduces the rate of the combustion. Even it causes large heat losses and forms a flue gas. It reduces the boiler efficiency also. Oxygen is also undesirable because it increases the amount of volatile matter and is associated with moisture, and even it leads to low calorific value and low cooking power. So oxygen reacts with hydrogen in the coal and also So the hydrogen available for the combustion will be lesser in such cases. So we can conclude that for better quality of coal, there should be more amount of carbon and sometimes hydrogen in the fuel, but it increases the volatile matter. So we are not much bothered about that hydrogen, but less amount of nitrogen, sulfur, oxygen, and ash contents. Now let us discuss one numerical. Given that a 2.5 gram of coal was heated in Jaldar's flask with concentrated H2SO4 in presence of K2SO4 and is then treated with excess of KOH. So the product will be ammonia here. The liberated ammonia is absorbed in the acid solution, non-volume of acid solution, that is 40 ml of 0.2 normal H2SO4. After the absorption, the excess acid required 7 ml of 0.2 NaOH for exact utilization, because we want to know how much amount of H2SO4 has been consumed by the ammonia. For that, we need to titrate H2SO4 with some other basic solution which they have given it as sodium hydroxide. So determine the percentage of nitrogen in the given sample. All the values have been given. We can put the values. We have percentage nitrogen as 1.4 into N1 into X upon W. N1 is given as 0.2N and X is given as 40 minus 7. W is 2.5 gram and it will come out to be, by putting all those values, it will come out to be 3.96. Next numerical we have related to sulfur calculations, percentage sulfur. In a bomb calorimeter, we have 2.25 gram of coal sample and it is taken for the determination of calorific value. The residue formed in the calorimeter was extracted with acid. Acid extract was treated with barium chloride solution. Means the sulfur present in the coal sample is treated with barium chloride solution and the precipitate of barium sulfate obtained. And the precipitate was filtered, dried and weighed. The weight of precipitate is 0.02 gram. Means weight of the barium sulfate precipitated is 0.02 gram. Calculate the percentage of sulfur in the sample. So we know the formula. Percentage sulfur is equal to weight of barium sulfate obtained, which is nothing but 0.02 divided by weight of coal sample taken in the bomb, that was 0.025 multiplied by 32 upon 233 into 100. So that's all for today. Thank you all.